Welcome to day two of the 2016 CSA conference. It's great to see all of you here with us this morning for what no doubt will be another outstanding keynote session with Dr. Roger Landry. I'm really pleased to have Roger here with us today. I wanted to share a little bit about his background before he comes up and shares his great message with us. Dr. Roger Landry is a preventative medicine physician, author of the award-winning Live Long, Die Short, A Guide to Authentic Health and Successful Aging. Dr. Landry is president of Masterpiece Living, a group of multidiscipline specialists in the field of aging who partner with organizations to assist them in becoming destinations for continued growth and centers for successful aging. Dr. Landry was trained at Tufts University School of Medicine and Harvard University School of Public Health. He specializes in building environments that empower older adults to maximize their unique potential. I've had the pleasure of knowing Roger for a few years, but I learned some things in preparing for this opening session today. I knew that he was a flight surgeon in the Air Force for more than 22 years, keeping pilots and other air crew healthy and performing at their best. This is really neat. One of his charges was world famous test pilot Chuck Yeager. Dr. Landry retired as a highly decorated full colonel and chief flight surgeon at the Air Force Surgeon General's Office right here in Washington, D.C., after duty on five continents and being medically involved in a number of significant world events, including Vietnam, the Chernobyl nuclear disaster, the Beirut bombing of the Marine barracks, the first seven shuttle launches, and the first manned balloon crossing of the Pacific. For well over a decade, Dr. Landry has focused his efforts on older adults as a lecturer, researcher, consultant, and author, and I ask you all to warmly welcome along with me, Dr. Landry.
Thank you, Christine. What an excellent introduction. Most of it's true. So, okay, you're asking, how does a guy who took care of pilots, test pilots, some astronauts, end up involved in aging? Well, they have some things in common. First of all, they both have a profound appreciation for the effect of gravity. No, but with flyers, they work in such risky environments, even though they're young, healthy people. It's very important that they be at their very best on a particular day. And it's the same, I think, as we age. Life becomes a risky environment because of where we are in our lives, and I think it's important that we be at our very best, and we'll talk more about that. When Christine asked me to do this, I said, oh yeah, absolutely, great. And then I said, you know, it's closing day. All the good stuff's already been said. But, you know, and I'm here with icons and mentors in positive aging, you know, Rick and Connie and Peter and Kay and Ashton. They've all said the good stuff, you know. And then I have a group who do something that I know they do work with older adults, but I don't have a clue of the other things that they do. And how do you blend all that together? There has to be some common ground, a bridge. So I thought about it. Yeah, I see three things in common with the attendees as well as those they work with. One, they have a pulse. Two, they're human. And three, they're aging. Bingo, right? So despite the potential intimidation of having such icons in positive aging here, I'm gonna proceed. So, there's a line from P.S. I Love You, the movie. And the guy's having trouble in relationship with a woman, and he finally says, what do you people want? And she admits, we don't know. We're dealing with some group who more and more know exactly what they want. The new older adult that's emerging is quite different than the other one, but I believe more than ever, they really do know what they want. And I think that that's very important to who we are and what we say and what we do. Judy Collins has, but is that enough? You know, I think about this, you know, what we want. I think we also need to know, and Jim Furman mentioned it yesterday, not only what do we want, and by the way, this is the first time after years of saying what, say, older adults want, I'm saying we. Because I know now it's me. I'm one of them, they're one of me, I'm aging, beautiful. But also, really, aren't we all human, have a pulse, and are aging? So it's what we all want. You know, it's a danger to homogenize older adults, and worse than that, it's a danger to look at them as some other species. It is we, and so the ability to empathize, and we'll get to that, I think is very important. So what do we want? But it's also, Judy Collins has a song, The Born to the Breed, that says, I hope from what you wanted, you get what you need. It's a beautiful phrase, and I think more and more, I think that's what we're here today. Not only for the people we work with, but for us too. Because, again, I think empathy is critical. So what is it that we want? What is it what we need? I'm going to go down to the very core. I've already alluded to it. This very core of what we have in common, being human. What is it like to be human, and how does that reflect on what we do every day? Now, there's a ticket to admission to this journey this morning. You're going to have you've probably all seen Cats. You've probably all heard the song Memory. But I want you to take away the fact that you are in an audience. I want you to be here today in a professional setting, learning more and more. And the ticket to admission is to get into the shoes of Grisabella here when she sings this. Feel what she's feeling, because it is common to those you deal with, it's common to who you are, it's common to the one sitting next to you. It's very critical, it's not to be forgotten. Please forget that, you know, you're an audience. Just be with Grisabella and feel this.
Thank you.
I won't profane that by saying that. I think you get it. Just in case you ever use videos, have the lyrics there, just in case it doesn't work. But that last phrase is pretty significant, I think, when you think of the stage in life of people you're dealing with. You may be your own stage in life, the stage in life you will be. Empathy, I think, is the ticket to admission if you want to be effective. So, happiness. We talked about happiness. What is it that makes people happy? Well, we've heard it, of course. They've said everything. Pew Report said that it is good health, it is good friends, and it is financial security. Those are the three you hear most common. And I think you are all involved in some way in one of those three, probably. And I think that's important. Seneca, writing on old age, said, let us cherish old age. It is cherish and love old age. It can be filled with pleasure if you know how to use it. And so there's an element there in choice. There's an element of control over your old age experience, and of course those you work with. I would like to matter. I would like to feel like I'm visible. I would like to feel part of a greater purpose than my own existence. And of course, those other things, the health, financial security. I was probably one of the happiest times in my life was when I was with an F-15 squadron deployed. And so there you had a group, a small group, committed individuals, selfless, totally about the greater good, feeling they were doing something very, very important. They were tight. It was very stressful at times. Many times there was a nuke on those wings, and sometimes people didn't come back. And so, stressful environment. Yet they were tight, they supported each other. We all did. I was the flight surgeon. Our families were there, and so we were tight as families. I took care of the families. I just felt part of a group that mattered, that I had a role, and it was important what I was doing. I don't think that's rocket science to feel that. But that's what I think we all look for, and we get it at certain times in our lives, but as we evolve through life, particularly in our society, we tend to get away from that. Life is a choice. We have heard that to the extent you're positive about your living experience, about your life, and positive about what it can bring, capitalize on your assets, you know, optimize, accommodate, that these people can live up to 7.5 years longer. They certainly have a higher quality of life just because of the way they go through life, but the data is very clear on this. You have a much better life experience. And so we do. We choose to be happy. You ask Stephen Hawking, chose to be happy. Yes, people who are under horrible circumstances, they can still choose to be happy. We choose to be happy. We also choose the opposite. It doesn't mean that there aren't challenges and that there are very uncomfortable and negative things, but it's how we view it, whether we optimize, whether we accommodate. So health seems to run through this thing, you know, and we can't, you know, as again, there's a danger in homogenizing older adults, but again, if we go down to the core of who we are as humans, and I'm going to stick to that, I can homogenize a little bit, because that's where we're starting. And I think we should be. I'm a physician, so I'm going to focus on health, successful aging, positive aging, optimal aging, whatever we call it, whoever you're with it, but I think we get what it is. And what is it that we can do to have the best experience? This is how we've looked at life for decades, centuries probably. We're born, we become our best, you reach a point, and then you begin to, you know, the things start to happen. Arthritis, heart disease, diabetes. Like a little cancer. Is there a little cancer, I guess? So, and then there's this decline, and it's painful, it's expensive, it's degrading, and can end up with loss of independence. There had to be a better way than a slide with a painful end, right? Rick tells me there is, and I believe it. So here we see the graph of many people that we see in our society and around us. Where they seem to stay at high levels of performance, maybe not at the very top there, but you know, a little ways down. They just maintain and they go longer and longer at high levels of performance, the best that they can be, which is a higher quality. Even when life throws them, like that little dip, throws them those curveballs that inevitably come with life. And they seem to be able to get right back up there, into the saddle, right? Okay, into the saddle. Stay in the saddle, like Aldo. And Aldo was a perfect experience. If you went to Case, an 86-year-old broke his back and yet loves to ride and ended up riding on a horse. So they do, they seem, and this is certainly a high quality of life. You certainly get more out of life. Ashley Montague says, die young as late as possible. And so there we go. And so since we can only live so long, the longer we stay at high levels of performance, the more likely that our end is not this, but this. Faster, probably less expensive. This is critically important for each of us as individuals, because I think we would choose that. It's also important for our society, because this right here is a huge mass treasure trove of human capital that we're losing when we get more of this than this. So wouldn't it be nice if we could all do that? Wouldn't it be nice if that were achievable? You know, for the most part, we felt that it's fate, genes probably more than anything, was our view. I want to age like leaves. You know, I'm from New England. I can still pack a pack. I have. I want to get more colorful as I age. I want to blend with others to make more beauty than I can alone. And when my time comes, I want to fall off the tree. Anyone else? A few. But a lot of you want to suffer. You know what? It's your choice. Like happiness, it's your choice. Let me tell you why. It was a long time ago now, in the early 80s, when Jonas Salk was on the board of the MacArthur Foundation, and he challenged them to study that dotted line, that higher road to aging. What's going on with those people? We've studied all the ones who decline and how to respond to that, how to support them and care for them and house them and do all that. Why don't we study these people? Maybe there's something in common, because you know what? We're aging as a nation. Soon every fifth person over 65, currently today. And so they did, and for 20 years they did it. And what they did, it was seminal work. And what they did started us all down the road to look at aging differently. It smashed the stereotype that aging was only about decline. Because what they found was, whether you took the dotted line or this solid line, it was mostly due to lifestyle. 70% for physical, 50% for mental. How we age was lifestyle, determined more by lifestyle, the choices that we make every day. So there it is. It's our choice. This is where we live, who we associate with, whether we continue to move, learn new things, whether we have meaning and purpose. All of these things we'll be talking about. But it was our choice, primarily. Again, this smashed the stereotype and launched us all, because of the great possibilities, it launched us all into a new, exciting, optimistic approach to aging in our own personal lives and in our careers and professions. It's due to lifestyle. What they found then were three things in common with those who aged in a better way, took the high road. First of all, they refused to rust out. They challenged themselves physically and mentally. We've heard about this. Kay gave a wonderful talk yesterday about how movement is inherent in who we are, and I'll be speaking more about that. Oh, there's another icon that freaks me out. Connie, you're there too. I'm glad to have you here. So it's moving. Challenging themselves physically and mentally. We'll talk more about this. But these people, again, refused to rust out. Secondly, they didn't want to be victims, so they acknowledged and they found out what their risks were, because we do have risks. Maybe from our parents. There are some genetic risks that we have to deal with. There's lifestyle risk, you know. You're wild and crazy when you were young, and now you're reaping a harvest of that. Yeah, that's, is that what you... I just had an ankle replacement. That's the result of wild and crazy when I was younger. And I said ankle, isn't that something? So for me, my risk is, besides behaving like a crazy person when I was young, is colon cancer, because my father had colon cancer. So So every 5 years, when a guy chases me with a 6-foot snake, I let him catch me, because you know what? My gastroenterologist friends tell me, I will not die of colon cancer. I can tell you, stand up here and say, I will not die of colon cancer. Because it's detectable, it's treatable, it's a slow grower. I may get it, a good chance I may get it. Will not die if I pay attention to my risks. And it's that way with so many diseases that when I was in Peter, we were in medical school, it was a death sentence. Pancreatic cancer, still vicious. But we're able to have, I just had a friend die, but he was diagnosed 3 years ago with pancreatic cancer. You had 3 years, you get him high quality of life, whereas before, 7 months when we were in medical school, at max, before someone would be gone. Saw his daughter married, saw his first grandchild, really. But so to pay attention to risk is important. But this was the big one. This was the big surprise from the MacArthur Foundation, because they found the people who aged in a better way were engaged in life. They weren't on the bleachers, they were on the playing field. Now we've heard about this, this is great. But you know what? In our society, we pasteurize older adults. Not like milk, like horses. And marginalize older adults. And our policies and how we look at all the ageism that Ashton talked about is there and presents a barrier that makes it very, very difficult to stay engaged intergenerationally with meaning and purpose, just connected to others. We'll talk about it more, but you stay in your home like most people want to do, and you become more and more and more isolated as your friends drop off, and then your spouse drops off, and you're really in trouble. So this is what they found. What you do as advisors, I know you're not, some of you maybe are official coaches, life coaches, but what a coach tries to do is to help someone reach their goals, whatever they choose to be. But I think you must be aware of that you're dealing with someone with a pulse who's human and aging, and there are certain things in common, and we're going to talk about what those are, and how you can perhaps ask some questions, perhaps you can prompt them, even without being a certified coach, to achieve what they want to achieve. With health, it's very difficult today. It's health. It's hard for me. It's hard for those of us who read all this literature on health, because there's so much out there, how to be healthy, you know? Eat bark, eat broccoli, you know? Run 100-mile marathons, you know, whatever. Use this machine, wear this piece of clothing. I mean, it's like, and then you say, okay, the research says this. And then in a month, no, the research says just the opposite. How do you know? And you do, you feel like this. And so going to the core of who we are as humans, how we got here, I think is a way for you to judge all of these claims. Everything that comes down the road, you're going to have a way to judge whether they are valuable. And here's how. We don't know how long man has been on Earth, but let's just say for argument's sake, it's been a year. 363 days of that year, we live like this. Hunter-gatherers. 363 days out of that year. That's huge. Who we are as humans was formed then. It's still with us. Society has changed radically in this last couple days of that year. Radically. But our physiology hasn't. Our physiology changes much more slowly. Our brains, our bodies, how we process things, how we look at things, what we need to be healthy has not changed radically. We survived as a species because our ancestors adapted to their society, to their environment, and to survive. We would not probably have survived as a species had our ancestors not adopted certain lifestyles. Those lifestyles have been passed on to us in our DNA and are with us today. And they are the same characteristics that we're rediscovering now are needed to age successfully, to be healthy. What a surprise. 363 days that we've been on Earth, we lived a certain way, and now in the last couple days we've been living totally differently, and we don't understand, and we're rediscovering why certain things are important, why movement is important, why they did a multi-billion dollar study to find out what is the best color to calm someone down. And it was green. No figure. How could that be? So what was that lifestyle? First of all, they moved. there are certain hunter-gatherer tribes that are still there, and we put a pedometer on their loincloth, and they'll go 18,000, 21, 24,000 steps a day. They move. It was their culture. It was what they did. And our physiology, we're rediscovering that our brains work better when we move. Our GI tract works better when we move. Our heart, our neurological system, everything works better when we move. Who'd have thunk it? Who'd have thunk it? We were quick learners, and we always had to learn in order to survive. So we learned from our elders, by the way, you know, where's the food? When should we move? How to build a shelter? What's the weather? Where's the water? Where's the food? How do you do this? How do you do this? Always learning. Now, I acknowledge that these people only lived to be about 30, 35, but it was infections and trauma that killed them. We've pretty much got a handle on that, so we're still the same organism. So old was different age chronologically, but not for practical purposes of speaking. There was a strong social network. This was absolutely critical for anyone to survive. A single human would never have done it. Everyone had a role. There was no pasteurization. Older adults were key to the society. They had the experience. In fact, the older adults taught the children. They raised the children because the others were out hunting and gathering. That, I believe, is responsible for what you would describe, and Peter and I also experienced this, the mystical experience of a grandchild. Sure, it's your child's child, but it's more than that. I think that this is something that has been passed on because of a long, eon-long relationship of older adults and young children, I believe. Anyway, they did. That was their role. They taught. Everything was with a higher purpose. In fact, I believe, well, I wasn't there, but I read that if you did something that was not in the interest of the group, the tribe, the town, you would be exiled. If it was just in your interest and not in the interest of the group, the greater good of the group. They describe people not even thinking of themselves as individuals the way we do, with our own wants and needs. It was about the greater good. I experienced some of it in the Heffertine Squadron, some of it, but probably not even close. We seem to be moving away from that. You'll notice that we're moving away from a lot of these. There was a social compact, and that was that, Clark, if you get sick, I'm going to help you. And you're going to do the same for me, and I can count on that. We could count on it. We didn't have Medicare, Social Security. We counted on each other. You may have grown up in little villages where you saw that, where Mrs. Smith washed her husband, and they're bringing her lasagna, and they're doing errands for her, and repairing her roof. That was still existence as early as 100 years ago, maybe still in some villages, but it was inherent in who we were. There was a slower pace. You think there was a slower pace of life? Think of life without time. 99% of the time we've been on Earth. Yes, without time. There was sunrise, sunset, moon, phases of the moon, seasons. That was it. Not a time-based society. More mindful in the moment what you were doing because there was no such thing as time as we know it. Whereas we're totally time-based. With that comes all the stress that we deal with and basically rotting us from within with that stress. Strong statement, but I believe it. We'll talk more about stress. Food and eating. They were hunter-gatherers, but they weren't that good at hunting for a long time. So the food that we ate for most of the time we've been on Earth, and as our gut was forming, and what we needed for nutrition was fruits, nuts, vegetables, wild grains, fish, and small amounts of meat. Small amounts because it was hard to bring down big game for a long, long time or preserve it. And that's what we grew up on as humans. That's what we function best on. That's basically a Mediterranean diet. So it's no surprise. Ooh, Mediterranean diet's good for us. We're rediscovering. It's okay, because we forgot. We forgot mostly since the Industrial Revolution. We'll talk more about that. And lastly, we were close to nature. I love this one, Peter. We weren't close to nature. We were nature. Nature was our living room. You know how you feel when you go to nature? You visit nature, and you feel so good, and you come back. This is because I believe we were nature. It was inherent in who we are. There's a book out, Last Child in the Woods. I really like that. This is documenting our almost systematic removal of our children from nature and the negative results that the author feels come from that, which is pretty well researched. And if you think about it, in the digital age, and you just take notice of how often you are within nature. Brian agrees. It is, it's remarkable. Less and less and less. I just spent some time, you may have heard of Yellowstone with Kay, on a horse, a creature, with a relationship with that horse, out in the way you didn't see any sign of human in Yellowstone National Park. And I mean, you were there, Christine, too, you did that. It's, you've all felt it. It's something that resonates with who we are. It's because it is who we are, and yet we're going the opposite way. Okay, so that's 363 days. About in our history, we became then agrarian, which added another, say, day and a half. We lived agrarian lifestyle. Basically the same characteristics. So again, now we have 364 and a half days out of the year where we live totally different than we do today. So what we're doing as we, the MacArthur study and all the research that has validated that, that MacArthur study sense, is really rediscovering who we are as humans, what we need to age in a better way, what we need to be healthy. And it's not rocket science. Well, if we just think about it, I mean, how can we be so arrogant? You know, it's like living for 100 years and letting the last 5 days of your life determine who you are as a person. Really. We're arrogant because we don't have anyone alive who knew differently. Again, maybe some of us lived in small villages and had in towns and had a sample of it. But that's what it is. So I know many of you know about the Blue Zones, but there are some who may not. Dan Buettner wanted to write an article in National Geographic. Where do people live to be very old and yet are very vital? And he searched the globe, identified five areas, called them Blue Zones, and well, that was Sardinia, Costa Rica, an island in Greece, Okinawa, and Loma Linda, California. In the middle of crazy Southern California, what's the deal? Well, there's a population of Seventh-day Adventists there, and they live a lifestyle very similar. Height, what they eat, they move a lot, they move. So there you go, even in that. So the same characteristics in these blue zones. Look at this one. Elders, cultural treasures. How many of you or the people you work with feel like cultural treasures? It makes a difference. So here's what I believe. I think when we live a lifestyle that is more akin to the way our humans have lived, and therefore we have inherited as absolutely necessary to be healthy and to age at our very best, we get what I like to call authentic health, because it is simply who we are as a species. From that authentic health comes this magical word, which we've heard about, maybe not using that word, but resilience. Because it isn't about not having stuff happen to you, right? It's not that life doesn't throw you curveballs, but it's your ability to bounce back. Resilience is the word. And you get that when you're living a lifestyle, you're connected and you're moving, you're the best that you can be, really. Having purpose and meaning. And you're able to weather those hits and not slide down that road so easily can happen. Selective optimization is just a matter of, yeah, bad things happen, you may be here. And we work with people who are here, but just the acknowledgement of where the risks are and what they might do to tweak their lifestyle, boom, changes that curve and frequently makes it better. It's selecting those things you can do, focusing on the things you can do, accommodating so you can do them as long as possible, and not just giving up and say, oh, well, I'm old, okay, I knew that was gonna happen, now I'll just sit around. And with that comes the public health term. We've talked about it, and I talk about it in my book, Live Long, Die Short. In public health term, it is compression of morbidity. Morbidity is when we're sick and impaired, and we want to compress that time, don't we? Right? Now, how many of you want to, you know, age like leaves and compress your morbidity? Less. All right. At Masterpiece Living, we track the people we work with. We look at their physical, mental, social, and spiritual. We're given the ability to assess their risk. And we track that data because it's very important to us to keep that data and use it, hopefully someday, to influence public policy. And this is, we didn't select anyone. We just took all the data we had at the time, dumped it into a bin, aggregate data, and looked at it. This is, the average age was 83 and a half. to 86 and a half. Growing, physically, mentally, socially, and spiritually. And this was just a matter of acknowledging where your risks were, and then having a community that believed that you can grow, support them, and provide them the opportunity to choose things that would lower their risks. You weren't challenging your brain enough, the ability to do that. You weren't connected enough, the ability to connect more. Not rocket science. So, in this book I have 10 Letterman, 10, everything's 10. 10 ways to exit, but I've changed that to questions. Questions that you might consider asking. Even if you don't ask all 10, maybe one, maybe two. Just probes into those you deal with to see if indeed they can get an insight into what they may, what part of their lives they may be neglecting and putting themselves at high risk for less than an ideal experience with aging. So, before we start though, I want to caution you. How many of you are doing what you made a New Year's resolution to do sometime along the way? Two, three, four, five. Yeah, I'm with that, six. I'm with the health audience. Usually I get none or one. Congratulations. Maybe they, I bet you what they agreed, what they said they would resolve is that they would never make a New Year's resolution. In this country, we only respect big, sexy change, braggable change. That's what makes us feel worthwhile. That's what we strive for, the New Year's resolution. You know what happens when we present ourselves with a huge change? Our brains act like our ancestors. There's a little part in our brain called the amygdala. And when it faces big change, our ancestors, that usually meant a threat. We react with a fear response. Lots of chemicals are released from the amygdala, and it sets up a process that dooms us. We cannot achieve what we have set out to do. There's many ways that that happens, but believe me, Dr. Moore here talks about it in his book, One Small Step Can Change Your Life. Great book regarding change in lifestyle. Probably one I would recommend, because if you're going to deal with people who want to make changes, it's usually pulling the reins on it rather than whipping it. So, that's why we fail. So in Japan, they have a way to, for organizational change, but also personal change. We actually brought it there, they kept it, we forgot it. And it's called Kaizen. And basically what it is tiny, small steps. Kay mentioned it yesterday. That is achievable. It doesn't set off this fear response. So Joe's a patient of mine. Joe is overweight. He has high blood pressure. He has high lipids, he's sedentary, hardly moves. Many years ago, I did get him to quit smoking, but that was about it. And here he is, he's a heart attack ready to happen. I'm doing the research for the book, and I said, it's worth a shot. So I said, Joe, for the next week, I just want you to stand during commercials. That's it. I said, that's all I want you to do. I said, don't go in the kitchen and get something to eat. Just stand during commercials. So in a week, Joe walks in. He's strutting in there. He's fitting. He's got a big smile. He hasn't failed. He has succeeded. He is proud of himself. It may be small, but he's proud. It's what I asked him to do. It was the goal, and he did it. So then I said, well, let's walk in place for the next week, Joe. Right? Did that. Fast forward. Joe, over a year and a half, lost 57 pounds, he went off all of his meds, he's no longer pre-diabetic, his lipids are down, his blood pressure is down, he's feeling good, he walks 5 miles three times a week. Wow. Just walks. Give it time, patience. He developed confidence and competence, self-efficacy, that he could do this. Now, his goal may have been to lose 57 pounds, but that wasn't the goal that he left my office in each time. His goal was to walk in place. That was the goal. Once he achieved that, you go on to the next one. It's all working towards that 57 pounds, but if you put up, I'm going to lose 57 pounds, very soon you're going to have a picture of a pig on your refrigerator. And you're going to have failed, and you're going to feel worthless, and that this isn't possible, and you're going to give up. Right? We've all been there. Small steps. In fact, to ask yourself, what's the smallest thing that I can do to work towards where I want to go. I had one guy who wanted to lose a lot of weight, and he says, okay, the smallest thing I can do, I'm going to spit out the first bite of a candy bar. I said, okay, good. He did that, and then the second bite, and then he eventually got off the candy bar. So, small steps. Please remember that as you deal with people with lifestyle changes, and you ask them these following questions, all right? First question, are you losing weight? This is use it or lose it, right? Didn't your grandmother talk about this, tell you this? This is use it or lose it. You know, I did work with you heard of the shuttle astronauts, but the astronauts that moved me were the Apollo astronauts. And I remember that time with Apollo. And those of you who were alive and saw it on TV, you remember there was a couple flights where after landing and they recovered them and brought them to the carrier, the helicopter, they had to carry two of the astronauts out of the helicopter. NASA went nuts. What's going on? This is our very best. We've trained them. They're heroes. And in less than 2 weeks, they're on their back. What's going on? Well, we didn't know then, but we know now in weightlessness. They weren't moving a lot, but we learned more about it. In weightlessness, if I just want to go over there, I just tap that. That's all I need. And I'll float over here effortlessly. I don't have to use any muscles. If I want to move my arm, I move it, but it has no weight. Nothing. The heart pumps a column of blood that has weight. It doesn't have weight in space. So the heart takes a vacation. The bones say, we're here to support weight. There's no weight. Let's get rid of all this extra calcium. We don't need it. And in a very short time, we have astronauts who go up in space now to the space station. Even though we know about this and we exercise, it's years before they're back to where they were. Some of them can lose up to 50% of their muscle mass in just a six-month mission. Why am I telling you this? You don't plan to go to space? You can, by the way, now, because you can get shot up there if you have a lot of money. I'm telling you because we humans are so intelligent. We are the most intelligent race on Earth, and we have invented something as close as possible to weightlessness, and you're all doing it now. We are a sedentary nation, defined by the Surgeon General's office. Almost half of us live a sedentary lifestyle. You know, 65% of the average waking American spends their time, 65% of their time, behind a screen of some sort, and we're usually sitting. You know, in Shakespeare's time, you would be listening to me standing somewhere along the way, sitting. We have drive-thrus, elevators, escalators. I love the one, people movers. Don't you love the ones who just stand there and move? We have invented every single way to prevent ourselves from moving. I think the less movement, the more successful we feel we are. We don't have to move. It's amazing. And we're reaping a harvest that we don't want to harvest. Every single chronic disease would be better if we were moving. Would be much better if we were moving. The risk would be less of getting it, or if we did get it, it would be less onerous, less of a challenge for us to go through a daily life. So whether it's your physical part, your mental part, or your social part, we have to use those things. So let's talk about the moving just a little more. A physician out of Mayo, and I can't remember his name, but his paper a few years ago caused quite a stir because the title of the paper was Sitting is the New Smoking. He actually calculated the risks of smoking a pack a day and a sedentary lifestyle, and the latter was more of a threat. And so I think that, remember, small steps, literally small steps. So I would recommend that you recommend to those you work with and you yourself put on a pedometer. My wife walked around Washington yesterday. She had her Fitbit on 21,000 steps. So, if we can get 10, that's great. But, find out advise that they find out what their average is over a couple weeks, and then resolve to just add a little bit to that. 10 steps, 100 steps a day. Park a little further, take a couple steps. It's easy to do. You don't have to run a marathon. People who work out, go to a gym every day for an hour, they receive a benefit from that. But if they go back to a job where they're sitting most of the day, they're still at risk. with their job, or, you know, or at home, still at risk. So the Blue Zones movement, they don't have exercise machines or fitness centers. Maybe they do in Loma Linda, but you don't need those. It is a lifestyle of movement. You move more every day, even if just a little. So, are you moving enough? Are you accommodating? Things happen. You resolve that you're not going to move. Kay gives you excellent advice, and I recommend that you get Kay's book or talk to Kay about how things you can do to accommodate when things happen. I was in college and I was chasing after a blonde folk singer, and I would have followed her anywhere, and I did off a cliff on a toboggan. And I really messed up my leg, and had to drop out of college, and took a long time to heal, but for 40 years I thought it was healed, but you know what, it really wasn't. So I kind of messed up my knee, and I got that fixed, that's easy, but the ankle was something else. Well, I live near Boston, and Celtics play in Boston, and they hurt their ankles, and their ankle doc, guess what, he replaces ankles. Not for Celtics, they won't be able to play anymore, but he does that. So here he was, just up the road. So I accommodated in the sense, I took a chance, but I made sure he had the, as best as I could see, the skill to do this, had a good result, and I did it. Oh, it's made all the difference in me and moving and how I'm able to do it and navigate through life. But you know what has happened in our country? The fitness industry, bless them, they're wonderful. But you know what? They only help about 5% of the population. The other 95 feel disengaged from it. I can't do it, or have tried it. And it's painted as, again, the heroic, sexy things that you have to do to be physically fit. If you have any doubt whether if you believe me or not, whether the fitness industry has kidnapped our view of physical health, why would you put an escalator up here? Really? Does that not say it all? This is the temple of fitness. This is the temple of physical health. Now, what about your brain? Nola here knows things that I didn't know when I was in medical school. You probably didn't even when you're in medical school. You certainly don't now if you're as a specialist. But she was the oldest person to get an undergraduate degree. Oh, but this is her great-granddaughter. She did it with her great-granddaughter. She also says, I'm considering a master's degree. Boom, she did it, 98. What she knows, we were taught that brains were relatively static organs after full development, and not a lot happened except to the negative. We lost cells and we lost abilities, and we just kept going until we were demented. Senile dementia. That's what we thought. You're standing here. You're a role model to all of us. So, what we have learned about the brain from scanning and all the new technology, it is marvelous. But let me just focus on one thing in particular, neuroplasticity. This is a trait of the brain. It is a lifelong trait. It's a lifelong ability to rewire itself in response to disease, challenges, different environments. So ladies and gentlemen, listen to that. You're really the architect of your brain. And this is lifelong. This is not just young brains. You are the architect. With neuroplasticity, to the extent we present our brains with a challenge, the brain will respond. Now, Jill Bolton Taylor was 39 years old when she had a stroke. She was a neuroanatomist at Harvard. And she couldn't walk, she couldn't talk. She was a neuroanatomist. She knew that if she worked at this, if she challenged her brain, she would get some results. Those cells were never coming back. They're dead. There's a big scar in her brain. But by challenging her brain, she was able to make new connections, new roadways, new pathways, new neural pathways in her brain that allows her to stand up at a TED Talk and talk about this. Jill Bolton Taylor, TED Talk. Hear it. Beautiful. It's magnificent. So, Nola knew this. We know this. And it was mentioned before, the Nunn study shows us that even when you have a brain, an Alzheimer brain, living a certain lifestyle seems to defer the onset of the symptoms of dementia. Some of these nuns died with Alzheimer's brains, but had no symptoms. So lifestyle, able to generate new pathways. We don't know, maybe Peter knows more than I do about the specific mechanism, but we're growing new neural pathways, redundant system. We used to be able to have a pathway to take us to Boston. That got wiped out. We started challenging ourselves and built a little pathway, and then a road, and then an interstate to Boston, the more we did it. So, optimistic. So what is it? What is this lifestyle that challenges it? It's, first of all, you have to be physically active, because the brain needs blood. It needs nutrients. It needs oxygen in order to do this, in order to exercise neuroplasticity. But we use our brain, use it or lose it. So if you're doing crossword puzzles, do them. But most importantly, learn new things. New things. When we scan brains, if we look at someone learning a new language, we see over time this brain getting heavy and thick as it's growing new pathways. But it doesn't. That's a good thing. A new skill, musical instruments, a language. That's great. But it doesn't have to be that. It can be a very small thing. Try eating with the non-dominant hand. All you need is a few more napkins, right? Shaving every. Don't shave with the opposite hand. I don't think that's a good thing. But that first stroke, guys, doesn't have to be the one that you've been doing for decades. And ladies with makeup, shake it up a little bit. Scare yourself. Get lost. just get lost. And when you're scared, that's a signal. Do this. Within reason. Do this. Try this. My mother was in a senior living community, very shy. My father had passed. And she knew what I did. She listened. She would sometimes be forced to listen to me. But anyway, she moved in with a senior living community and says, I'm going to eat with someone new at least once a week. I'm afraid to do it. I'm nervous. I'm shy. Within a year, she was the head of the welcoming committee. It's magnificent. She blossomed. My brother and I didn't even recognize her. So do that. It's healthy for you. It's healthy emotionally for you. It's certainly helpful. It helps your brain, so your cognitive function, and can only delay the onset of bad things happening. It can only help. And we're learning more and more about just how to best to do that and what's the best advantage. But using your brain. Connection, we've talked about that. It is inherent in who we are and the story of our ancestors that we are connected in unity. Now I know it. People are annoying. You don't always want to be with them. We need our alone time. But the Maasai say we are not human unless we're with other humans. Think about it. It's true. We're not. And we have an absolute need to be with humans. We're better together. A book by that title. Long-term studies show that when people are connected, they're 2 to 5 times less likely to be affected by heart disease, dementia, and cancer. 3 biggies, just being connected. I'm not sure what that was, but we do now. We know that when people are connected, they have very powerful immune systems, among other things. And we can measure immune system efficacy and strength now, and robustness, and we see this, among other things. There are many we're still learning about all of this. Connections, very, very important. Stamatis here, who lives on the Greek island, one of the blue zones, and he's 102. And as you can, if you can't read it, it says, it's the wine. I drink it with my friends. But Stamatis' story is even more powerful. He was born here, but moved to the United States. He was actually a Greek Freedom Fighter. He was wounded. He jumped on Queen Elizabeth, went over to the U.S., started a life, and raised a family. And around 60, he was diagnosed with lung cancer. His physicians say, he got about a year. I'm always reluctant. It's almost challenging. So he said, funerals are cheaper in Greece. So I'm going to go back to this island, this blue zone. And he did. For a little while, he stayed in bed. And then he thought he'd go down to the town. The kids he grew up with were there. Hey, Stamatis, you're back. Let's have a wine. And he would go every day down with them. And then more and more connection. Then he started a vineyard and he started working. But the big thing was that he was moving a lot more and he was connected with friends. You get the story? He's still alive. He's 102. Someone asked him, how's your physician feel about that? He says, oh, he's dead. My friend John Spooner says it all. Better to eat fries with friends than broccoli alone. I endorse that fully. That's how powerful it is. Your risks. We talked about your risks. You can't ignore your risks. It's like driving a car with no brakes. You're going to navigate through life with high risks and ignore them? That's nuts. Some people approach health things that look like an ostrich. They want to hide from them. But again, with colon cancer with me, I pay attention to that. I'm going to be able to, I can say, and I won't, die of colon cancer. So it's paying attention. The risks are many. They're like buzzards that are always there, you know. They're up high when you're young, and you get older, they're like a Hitchcock movie. You know, they start taking bites out of you. But whether the risks are self-induced, you know, which is okay, or these are self-induced, brain, food, slips, golfing with a grizzly on the green, see that? Anyway, whatever they are, it's paying attention to them, and where we have the ability to lower that risk, I think that is just, it's not rocket science. That is what we must do. There are other risks. I use this slide when I speak to people who are evaluating where they should live in the next phase of their life. And I use this for a particular purpose. Certainly you don't want to drive with a bad driver. But more importantly, don't let others put you at risk. In other words, don't buy into a societal stereotype that aging is only about the climb. All the ageism that Ashton talked about. Don't buy into that. Like Kay talked about. We heard so much of that today. Low expectations, internalized lower expectations are very powerful. They're very powerful in a negative way. And so don't let others, the society, even your children. I tell people the worst thing they can do is consider moving in with their children. If anyone wants to do that, say absolutely not. Our friend Teresa and Kay mentioned it yesterday. There's such a thing as helicopter children. So older adult children hover over their parents and want to eliminate all risk. I won't allow them to grow, blossom. I had a guy who said, we just had a party for my mother. She had a birthday. We had a nice birthday party out in the backyard. And she was late. And we said, oh, bet she fell and broke her hip. Well, it's better call the ER. So let's check. They look up, she comes down in a parachute. She didn't ask her family whether she should do that. Is your age or your spirit in charge? The one I use is never act your age, because to act your age is to buy into this stereotype right here in today's society. So you ask, is it your spirit, what you love, what you want to do, what you always wanted to do, is that premier in your thoughts and mind and in judging and maneuvering and helping you maneuver through life? Or is it your age, a number? You heard I met Chuck Yeager. One day at Edwards Air Force Base, Flight Test Center, he walks into my office for a physical. Yeah. It's an aviation buff, and the younger people may not know, he's the first one to break the sound of right stuff, General Yeager. So we do the physical, he's very healthy. He's in his late 50s at the time, I'm in my 30s. And then he just sits there, puts his feet up, he can do anything he wants in life. He starts talking about his experiences, all those ones we read in the red stuff and some we don't even read about. And I'm just transfixed. Then he gets quiet. And he says, you know what, Doc? He says, I think on the 50th anniversary of breaking the sound barrier, I'm going to do it again. You know what I did? 30 years old, I knew everything. Cocky. I said, Chuck, you'll be 73 years old then. He looked at me and said, what's your point? Beautiful. There's a lesson in aging. I never forgot it from the man. He did break it on the 50th, the 55th, the 60th, and the 65th anniversary of breaking the sound barrier. He did it. So to the extent that we embrace low expectations associated with a number that, you know, why do we retire at 65? Does anyone know? The Germans were the first one to have basically a social security system. And this was the late 19th century. And they had to pick a number when they would pay the benefits. Now, the average life expectancy was 48 then, so they said 65. It was a good safe number. Somehow that got chiseled on a rock somewhere. What does that mean? It's crazy. This one's important, and this has to do with our time-based society and the huge amount of stress that we are all subjected to. We inherited from our ancestors a stress response. You've all heard about it, the fight or flight mechanism. You know, and that was to save us. You're walking down a path, there's a lion jumps out, and you can either fight that guy and be as strong as possible or run like the wind, faster than you could ever. You've done it. You've stepped off a curb. Here comes a truck. Woo! You're right back. You can jump a fence. We see people lift Volkswagens off people who are trapped, and soldiers do things you didn't believe were possible because it is a stress response. It is a survival response. It is all hands on deck relative to the body. We shut down systems we don't need, and we concentrate and focus on the ones we do need, heart, muscles. And that's what it's meant to be short-term. We, as humans, and only us as humans, have the ability to trigger this with our thoughts, with our chattering minds. I don't know what's happening now. You're sitting there looking at me and saying, God, he's handsome. You know, what's for lunch? Why didn't he wear a tie? Oh, you know, the election. Oh, I don't know what ISIS, you know, or the kids. And we're nuts, you know, it's chattering mind. We believe we are our mind. Our minds are only tools. We are souls and spirits. This is a tool. And yet it runs the show. And it's always ripping us out of this moment. You say, live in the moment. Well, this chattering mind rips us out of that moment. And, you know, we're thinking about to-do lists and everything we haven't done or relationships. And it just rips us up. It's like flooring the gas and stepping on a brake. Just rips us up. So much, you know, that stress that you've been dealing with, I can pretty much guarantee it's self-induced. Really. There are stressful situations. But when faced with a stressful situation, there's only three things that you can do. All right? One, fix it. Or make a plan to fix it. Then you have a step. It's like Joe, you know, standing up for commercial. You have a step. You're going to do that. So you're focused on that step. Two, walk away. Not your problem. Yesterday was National Dog Day, and they had a phrase there. It said, approach life like a dog. If you can't eat it or play with it, pee on it and walk away. Beautiful. And three, accept it. It is what it is. You know, the election is what it is. All you can do is vote. That's it. You know, ISIS is what it is. There's not much you can do about that. Don't internalize it. Don't throw it in a big bag and carry it around with you and bring it up every now and then. Relationships, bad things that happen. That's self-induced stress. Fix it or plan to fix it. Walk away like the dog or accept it. That is associated with peace, much better health, because stress accentuates. Speeds up our rate of decline for just about every condition, every chronic condition that we face. And it makes life extremely uncomfortable. And it starts early. Okay? Starting early. So life may not be the party you hope for, but while you're here, you might as well dance, right? Purpose. What is it you do in a sense of what is your life's purpose? What gets you out of bed? This is a good question to ask those you work with. Because sometimes it's you may get the answer, I'm retired. And if you do, you are in trouble. They're in trouble. What is it you do? Without a purpose, we wither. Mary Oliver, she's a poet that lives on Cape Cod. Did you ever meet her, Connie, or interview her? You did? She's a different kind of woman, but she's a very good poet. She lives in Provincetown. And she has a poem, Summer Day, I believe. And in that is a line. It says, tell me what it is you plan to do with your one wild and precious life. That's a question for not only for young people, it's a question for all of us. Every day. What is it you plan to do with your one wild and precious life? Again, if we don't have purpose, we wither. If we don't have purpose, we don't... It's not bounding out of bed, okay? It's getting out of bed in the morning. That's enough. it's critical to who we are. And from my experience and from my reading and research, the kind of purposes that do stick and motivate people usually involve other living things. Humans, animals, the environment, you've heard it, we've talked about it. These are things that tend to motivate people in a very substantive way and a very healthy way. Alfie Date is the oldest man in Australia. He's 109 years old. And he gets out of bed every day to knit sweaters for penguins. These penguins have been subjected to oil spills. They preen their feathers, ingest the oil, and die. He knits them sweaters. They can't do that. They live. Plus, they look cool, don't they? That's what Alfie does. It does not have to be grandiose. It does not have to be braggable. It just has to be meaningful to you and to those you work with. Kids, where are the kids? You gotta have kids in your life. Our ancient tribes, it was inherent. We were a mixed intergenerational group. Children were the sign that we were gonna survive as a species. It was a blessing, huge. So kids, you know what happens? As we age, we become less, you've heard this, we become less and less connected to children if we don't watch out. Our society will lead us down a road into isolation from other generations. Then we can complain about the millennials, and we can complain about the kids. And it, again, it leads to isolation, and it leads to higher risk for bad things happening to you. Kids. Kids. And when those kids are so good looking, Jackson, Dylan, Hunter, and Abigail. All right. That was taken yesterday, by the way. So. Are you having fun? Do you laugh? How many times? When's the last time you had a good belly laugh? Right here. My job is done. True, and that's why I flavor so much of what I do with laughter, because first of all, it keeps people attentive. It's a pleasant experience, but it's a healthy experience. So laughter, you don't know the story of Norman Cousins, Anatomy of an Illness, he wrote a book. Back in the 70s, he was diagnosed with a terminal disease. They told him probably about a year. So he didn't feel so hot about that. He's in the hospital, he says, oh boy, but I always feel better when I laugh. So he checked out of the hospital. He got a movie projector, it's in the 70s. Got Marx Brothers movies, which he liked. Candid Candor episodes, which he liked. Came back to the hospital, started playing the cinema, and he's laughing, and he's laughing. The staff's laughing, because it's a social connector. And he laughed himself into remission for 30 years. He died of another disease. Laughter. We didn't know what the mechanism was, but we do now. Much like social connection, the immune system is extremely powerful in those who have an optimistic view. The centenarian study in New England, what is the most common characteristic of those people? Optimism. What do they have to be optimistic about? They're over 100. But they know things are going to happen. I'll deal with that when it happens. You know? And they face life with an element of joy and happiness and optimism. Now, what happens to us? Life happens. But if something else happens, and it has to do with my aerospace medicine background, most of you think, and I'm usually dealing with even older audiences, most of you think you have a nice, neutral expression on your face. But with many of you, what I see is, it's gravity. It's gravity working. But the face is a huge window to us. It's a huge communicator, more so than words. 60, some say 70% of communication is nonverbal, and the face is huge. So to walk through life with that kind of face, not intentional, sends a message of, I don't want to talk to anyone, don't bother me, I'm miserable, I'm cranky, you know, don't even come close, I don't want to have anything to do with you. And many times that's not the intent. Hopefully most of the time it's not the intent. So when we go on TV, right, don't they say, you know, think like you have a slight smile on your face and that'll come out as neutral. You feel a little stupid, but you see, you can check it in the mirror. Those are the young ones, you probably don't have to worry so much. But as gravity starts to kick in, you don't want to send a message that's going to isolate you, raise your risk for aging in a worse way. So, laugh. So these are the four things I recommend in the book. So for homework and for those you work with, if you want a nice quick homework, move a little bit more, a little more. Remember Heitzel? Move a little bit more, try something new, reach out to people. You know, we in New England are really friendly. If you give us 30 years, we'll be your friend. It's not that bad. It's not that bad. But, you know, really, reach out to people. You know, a server, cashier, waiter, someone on the, you're both better for it. It is who we are. It is in our very DNA. And challenge yourself. Scare yourself every day. Get out of your comfort zone. You know, is bungee jump? Yeah, well, maybe, maybe not. But it doesn't have to be. Just do something like my mother. It's a little bit out of the way. And don't accept low expectations. Take a Jaeger effect to your life and those you work with. Don't be on the fence. You know, Yoda in Star Wars says there is no try. There is do or don't do. So it's today, ladies and gentlemen. And it's today with those you deal with. Do or don't do. Don't be on the fence. Because, Caveman Norman gave me this slide, you'll be like these guys. For those of you who can't read, we have a couple of dinosaurs watching the ark sail away, and it says, oh crap, was that today? It is your choice, it is our choice, it is the people you work with, their choice, as to which road they take, because lifestyle is the major determinant. That lifestyle is not rocket science. It is what how our ancestors lived, and we have to creatively take those traits and bring them back into our lives in this time-based, high-tech, rush, frenetic culture that we're in. We're not going to be hunter-gatherers. I'm not advocating that, but I'm advocating that we recognize what it is to be human and to be healthy, that we receive from our ancestors, and get that into our lives. George Eliot, great. It's never too late to become what you might have been. This is how we used to look at retirement and old age. Comfort and security was everything. But we know now it's not enough. I knew I'd get an awe of that. And how do we get it? How do we get it? Remember, it's lifestyle. So you're not going to win the lottery unless you buy a ticket. You have to do something. People you work with have to do something. Nudge them into it with Kaizen. Small steps. Build their sense of advocacy, of self-efficacy, of confidence and competence that they can do it. Don't put them in a situation or challenge them or challenge yourself to something that you're going to fail at. The important thing is that wherever you are and as you age, that you're in a situation, whatever that is, where you are connected to others and will remain connected to others, where you are active both physically and mentally and stimulated by your peers, we very much reflect the character, lifestyle characteristics of our social network. If they're overweight, we're usually overweight. If they're smokers, we're usually smokers. So be in a place where people are active, both physically and mentally, and stimulate you. And where you are fulfilled, you have meaning and purpose. You see those around you. And a place that believes that you can grow, where you're going to continue to grow. I'm going to close with a story from my internship. And Kay, I'm sorry, you've heard this story. Maybe a couple of my colleagues have, but I did my internship in Maine Medical Center. And one night I was on the emergency room. It was 12-hour shift, 7 at night to 7 in the morning. It was a blizzard this night, 2 feet of snow. We were really busy, and at 7 a.m. when I got off, I just wanted to go home. I was very tired. I trudged through the parking lot. It wasn't even shoveled. And went out to my Volkswagen boat. You know, we all have boats. So for 2 hours, I shoveled out this Volkswagen boat. Finally got it there. Now, did any of you have one of these in cold weather? So they had lousy heaters and defrosters, right? Did your locks freeze? Yes. So today, my lock's frozen. I can't get into this car, and I'm really tired. So I go into the emergency room. I think I'm a smart guy. I take a small face towel, and I put very hot water on it, and I rush out, put it on there. No, 3 times I did that. So then I got a Bunsen burner. All right, a little fuel. I got it, lit that baby, put it under the lock, you know. But the wind was blowing the flame out, so I couldn't get it hot enough. So, okay, I have with me at all times a source of warm fluid. So, picture, maybe you don't want a picture. there defrosting the lock. And a voice behind me says, "What are you doing in my car?" Same year, same color as mine, right next to mine. I said, "I have a right." I shoveled it out for you. I tell you that to make you healthy. Think of what your immune system is now. I tell you that because there's a moral. Let's not try to come up with solutions before we know what the problem is. So the problem is not how many people are aging and the demographic and everything. The problem is twofold. It's how our society looks at aging and Masterpiece Living and these people in this room, you, Positive Aging Movement, we're all going to eventually change that. We're going to break through and we're going to see that there's a better way. It's an easy way, it's an inexpensive way, and it's got a huge return on investment. But in the meantime, that's going to take a little time. It's not so much what society that's important, it's how you look at aging. How you personally and how the people you work with look at aging. Because to the extent that you look at it in a non-Jaeger way, a number, or expected low expectations, that's probably what's going to happen. Henry Ford said, if you think you can do something, or you think you cannot do something, you're probably right. It's a very, very powerful motivator. So if you have to break it down into one little sound bite to help those you work with, how about this one? Tibetan proverb. Secret to living well and long is to eat half, walk double, laugh triple, and love without measure. Thank you. Thank you. We have time for questions. Good. Okay, great.
Questions, comments, thoughts? Okay.
Do you make house calls?
I make house calls,
yeah. Hi there. My name's Lisa Marshall from Michigan. Loved your talk.
Thank you. I know you, I could tell you're a very good audience member. You laughed in all the right places.
Very curious what your research has revealed about sexuality, and
well,
I'll let you answer it however you feel.
I like it. But I have to say that, you know, when we started 15 years ago, we were based on the successful aging research. This was all new. It was there was a lot of pushback to some of the things that we were doing, so we tried not to be as provocative as least provocative as possible. We wanted people to be willing to answer the questions that we were asking in order to get data. And so we laid off of that for a long time, but we fully realized it's important, and more so. And we're in an environment now where it's a much more acceptable thing. So I promise you, we have just begun to start fashioning some questions. We will do that. We know it's important. Mea culpa, we haven't done it until now, but we didn't want to get blown out of the water for something like that and not do the good stuff if we get to it.
Okay,
it
is the good stuff.
Meanwhile, people are getting married in the senior living communities where they're retirement communities, relationships. Sun Health is having a lot of trouble with public displays of more than affection. And so we know that we're rewriting the page relative to sexuality and aging with our society.
What do you suggest regarding working through pain, whether it's clients, explaining to clients on ways to get around that pain or to get through it?
There's a very famous story that during World War II, in the landing at Anzio, very vicious landing, lots of wounded, and a medic wrote a report that a good many of the very seriously wounded that he had refused anesthetics. They refused morphine. They wanted to save it for their friends, and they knew they were going home, that this was over. This was the end of their horrid experience. They expected to survive, and so they were able to think differently of pain. I have a friend who was shot down in Vietnam, and he was a prisoner for 7 years. And every day, he was in solitary confinement for almost 2 years. And every day, he was brought down to be tortured. And it was usually, ripping the arms up. And he had fractured his arm during injection. And you know what he told me? This has more to do with social connection, but it also was relative to pain. He said, I used to look forward to them coming to get me. I'm in solitary confinement. I'm not hearing this before the tapping and everything. I'm totally isolated. And so a guard would come down. He wasn't a bad guy. He'd get me out. He'd talk to me. He'd touch my arm. He'd hold me when we went down. I didn't like the torturer so much. I could get through that. I could do that because it was much more important to me to be with other people. What I'm telling you is that we have discovered, and perhaps Peter, maybe you can help out, but we have discovered that where our focus is with pain, to the extent we focus on pain, that becomes much more of a factor in our lives. Much more intense, I'm sure, or perceived as intense, it is intense. And to the extent that we focus on positive things, that this isn't the end of the world, I will get better, this is a passing thing. When I think there's no hope and that this is all I'm facing is this pain, and that's a difficult situation. But to the extent someone focuses on the positive things, that pain is experienced as less. Peter, anything?
Roger, that was brilliant and funny, and that's an amazing combination. And the use of photography is just amazing. I'm blown away, so thank you. Let me not specifically ask that, but ask you to tell a joke about our healthcare system. It is a joke. It's not funny. And so maybe you could just address it about how you deal with folks to help them help their doctors and be healthier. In other words, what do you say about the conversation you have as an individual, or we as a group have with our healthcare system to make them part of this movement, not, quite frankly, people that we have to resist to be healthy?
Sure. Peter's a physician, so he's been through the same process I have. Did I answer your question? We can talk more. And this is a physical reality. You can actually see the actual signals going through the pain fibers that are decreased when someone has a very positive attitude. When I left the military, I only went in for 2 years. I stayed 23 because in the military, we were really incentive. Aerospace medicine that I practiced was a preventive medicine specialty because these guys were healthy, mostly men. And it was my job to keep them that way and performing at their best. That's preventive medicine, population health. When I stayed in because the military was incentivized. They didn't want to use pilots who they had spent millions training, or the airplane, which sometimes went into the billions. And so they invested in that, and they allowed me to be a real preventive physician, engage with people, able to learn about them, live with them, deploy with them, take care of their families, and really become, and that's why it was such a positive experience. When I left, I went into clinical medicine. This large healthcare system wanted me to do all of their prevention, and I did for 3 years. After 3 years, I was called in, and the CEO said, "You're doing a fantastic job. You're hurting our revenue." We are, unfortunately, for many, many reasons. One that's based upon revenue, response to disease only, and spend what our national budget is 1 or 2% on prevention and public health of our healthcare budget. It's long entrenched, as you know, Peter. The things that you were taught and said, I think back now in medical school, and I was taught nothing really about prevention. I was taught nothing about spirituality and health. I was taught nothing about those things, and a holistic approach. I think it's changing, and I'm glad it is. I think some of our healthcare, the fact that we are sometimes incurring a fine if we have a recidivism on certain diagnoses, I think that's beginning to motivate the healthcare community to pay attention to not only curing the disease, but preventing it from happening again. And it's not, they are highly motivated, altruistic people. I mean, if I'm a physician now, I probably have 8 minutes with someone. And they come in with a problem, and many want to talk and bond and hold their hand, and you can't do it. And so what do you end up doing? Probably writing a prescription. And so it's a system, and Right. So I think we're highly motivated people in a system that's very difficult. I think we have to, much like our maybe our electoral process, we have to get big money out of determining what happens in medicine, the machines that we buy, the diagnostic equipment, the medication, that sort of thing. And I'm afraid, I mean, I think public policy and incentives that will almost always, and it sounds negative, but I don't mean to be, the bottom line, you know, revenue, return on investment, I think when we begin to incentivize that, and when we see that we're going to be a better nation, better health care, for less money, with happier people, when we focus on other things than just responding to disease, and I know you know all that, but I thank you for giving me the opportunity to tell everybody else.
Well, and with that great closing note, please join me in thanking again Dr. Roger.